the modern prophets or working around the modern prophets, through the modern prophets. Also using it to get ready for the Advent and Christmas season, which is just around the corner. Remind everybody, we'll meet tomorrow night for men's ministry, my house, 7 o'clock. All you need to bring is your lounge chairs, lawn chairs, and might want to dress warm. It's going to be cool. Might want to bring a blanket to throw over your legs when we're sitting there, but we're going to have the fire roaring pretty good. If you would like to carpool, you're welcome to be here at the church between 6:30 and 6:45. The bus pulls out at 6:45 promptly. So don't show up at 6:46 unless you want to drive on my house. But we are so excited that everybody is coming and going to be with us tomorrow night. It'll just be a great time of food, fellowship, and devotion as well. So I really look forward to that. Then our holiday craft fair put on by our Helping Hands. All the money goes for the Hollywood Christmas offering. That is on Friday from noon till 6. And then again on Saturday morning till about 2 o'clock, I think, on Saturday. Then Sunday we meet for regular worship in the morning, regular worship at night. And that will be the last time we will meet till after Thanksgiving, because I'll be gone on that Wednesday before Thanksgiving. Lots of y'all are going to be cooking. And so we have just traditionally taken off the Wednesday night before Thanksgiving. But we've got a lot to do in the next few days. And it's just an exciting time to be a part of God's family and Trinity. Malachi chapter 4. Beginning in verse number 1, we'll read the entire chapter. It's not very long. For behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and all evildoers will be stubble. The day that is coming shall set them ablaze, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave neither root nor branch. But for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. You shall go out leaping like calves from the stall, and you shall tread down the wicked, where they will be ashes under the soles of your feet, on the day when I act, says the Lord of hosts. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes, the rules that I commanded him at Horeb for all of Israel. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. He will turn the heart of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with the decree of utter destruction. What a marvelous passage, not only to illustrate the symbolic value of words, but also to give us insight into the opening of the New Testament. We are not certain that Malachi is necessarily the last of the prophets to write, but traditionally he is the last included in the Old Testament canon as it concerns the prophets. We know that between the close of the Old Testament canon and the beginning of the time of Christ is around 400 years. We know that God was at work in his people during that 400 years. There were a number of things that happened during that time. John the Baptist on the scene. He is, according to Jesus' own words to his disciples, the Elijah that was to come, that was prophesied by Malachi the prophet. I'd like you to turn with me for just a short reading in Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1. There are other passages of Scripture that we can also turn to. But it's Mark chapter 1 that gives a real summary of the beginning and ministry of John the Baptist. Beginning in verse number 1 of chapter 1. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in Isaiah the prophet. Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. The first thing that we need to take note concerning John the Baptist is that he came by word of prophecy. It was not simply Malachi that told us that before this awesome day of the Lord comes. And think back to what we read in chapter 4. How God is going to set everything ablaze like an oven. And yet, what it has reference to is to the preaching ministry of John. John comes by word of prophecy. There is no indication whatsoever that miracles ever accompanied his ministry, though surely they may have, but since the Holy Spirit did not see fit to record them, if they did, we are to not argue from silence, but only to speak from what the Bible tells us. His was a preaching ministry, and through his preaching ministry, he literally set Israel ablaze. The people were pouring out of the cities. They were traveling across the 30 miles of desert to get to the Jordan River Valley, where there John was preaching and baptizing. He had sparked the imagination of the spiritual heart of Israel. And he proclaimed that he was the forerunner. When asked if he was the Christ, he said, no, I'm not the Christ. When asked even if he was Elijah, making sure that there was this understanding, because what was happening, knowing that Elijah had been taken up to heaven in a whirlwind, and reading the passages of Scripture like we have in Malachi, there was a group evidently within Judaism that was reading that part of Scripture which is poetic and symbolic as if it was literal. And so they asked John, are you Elijah? And John's answer to that question was no. Number one, because the Bible doesn't teach reincarnation. Number two, because Elijah had not descended from heaven, or ascended from heaven, into the earth full grown. John the Baptist was brought to us by the prophetic word and by the natural coming together of his mother and his father. Now, we'll talk more about him in just a moment. But it's important for us to understand that later on, Jesus proclaims that John is the Elijah to come, telling us that verses like Malachi chapter 4 are to be read and understood in a symbolic way. Elijah has come in the person of John the Baptist, and John has come by conceived by the Holy Spirit, Christ within her womb, travels down to be with Elizabeth, and the second that Mary enters into the room, John, who is still in his mother's womb, by word of prophecy, by coming to us miraculously, there in his mother's womb, is filled with the Holy Spirit, the Bible says. We might ask the question, when does regeneration take place? When is it that God's Spirit moves on us? Listen, it can come at any time. God's Spirit may move on us during the preaching service by which our blind eyes are opened and then we respond in faith and repentance to the gospel. It may be that the Holy Spirit moves on us and there is a separation of a length of time before we, by faith and repentance, receive Christ Jesus. It is even possible, according to the Scripture, that an unborn child, without ever having heard the gospel, not able to speak, not even yet having taken a breath on their own, can be regenerate by the Holy Spirit of God. Why? Because it is not based, our regeneration is not based on our individual decision. Regeneration is based upon the decision of God, the Holy Spirit, and God alone. Regenerate in the womb, John leaps at the presence of the Savior. John comes to us by word of prophecy, and John comes to us miraculously. The Bible says, according to the Gospel of Luke, that he's in his mom and dad's home at some point in his life, recognizing that he is a few months older than Jesus himself. At some point in his life, John retires to the desert. Now, whether he is in the desert a matter of months, or whether he is in the desert a matter of years, the Bible doesn't tell us. The point is that there in the desert, he prepares to be the forerunner. You will also remember how his own father, Zechariah, prophesied that he would be the forerunner. Isaiah had said it. Malachi had said it. Zechariah himself said it. John comes to us by word of prophecy. John comes to us through a miraculous conception. And then he appears. One of the things that I find interesting about both John and Christ Jesus, now recognizing because of his father Zechariah is no doubt from the tribe of Levi, from the family of Aaron, John then could have served as a priest. Because in that day and age, not our day and age, wasn't until later that Jews began to trace their family tribes based upon the maternal. At this point in time, they traced their family tribes based upon their fathers, on the paternal line, not the maternal line. And one of the things that I find interesting is that according to the Old Testament, someone who was of the tribe of Levi, of the family of Aaron, could begin their priestly duties at the age of 30. We know that Christ Jesus was about the age of 30 when he began his own ministry. We know from the Scripture that Jesus comes to us from the tribe of Judah, but according to the book of Hebrews, he is after the order of Melchizedek. He is not only prophet and king, he is also our high priest. So Jesus appears at the age that a River Jordan confessing their sins. What is taking place about this one who comes to us prophetically and miraculously is nothing less than a national revival. There is a national spiritual revival among the people of God right before the entrance of Christ Jesus on the scene. Is it any wonder that the crowds by the thousands were to follow Christ Jesus? Now think with me if you would. For 400 years, there is no prophetic voice. They've read about the prophets. They've read about the Holy Spirit of God filling an individual and bringing people to faith in Christ through the preaching of the word. But all anyone has ever known is the voice of the rabbis reading and explaining the scripture in the synagogue. Now all of a sudden, someone new, something that is old, that is out of their historic past, has come upon their present, and the people are literally flooding out of the seas to hear John preach. It's something old, that's something new. John is preparing the way not only by his preaching, and the message that is preached, but he is preparing the way for Christ by readying the people for this outdoor preacher, for this wilderness voice. God is at work in John. As we continue. Now John, verse number 6, was clothed with camel's hair. He wore a leather belt around his waist and he ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." What a message. John comes prophetically. John comes miraculously. John comes in austerity. He owns nothing. His clothes are simple. His diet is evidently whatever he finds there in the Jordan River Valley to eat. This is a guy who truly is reminiscent of those Old Testament prophets like Elijah, like Elisha. Can you imagine how the people must have felt in this day and time to see in their own lifetime the Bible, if it were, coming alive right before them? Everything they've read about all of a sudden is taking place. What I find so interesting about this, besides the fact that it's prophetic and miraculous and John is so austere, I find it absolutely amazing that the way that God is going to set the land ablaze as if it were in an oven is through preaching. Through preaching. Not through the preacher, but through preaching. How often, at least myself and possibly you as well, have thought, you know, if we could just do miracles like the apostles, or if we could just do miracles individuals like Elijah. We could grab this sinful world's attention so quickly. And yet we should be reminded that when God chose to set the world ablaze for His Son, at least as far as the Scripture tells us, it was only by preaching. Preaching accompanied by the Holy Spirit of God is always enough. Always enough. For it is by the Word that our lives are transformed. It is by the Word that we encounter Christ. Not simply the reading of the Word, though the reading of the Word is powerful in and of itself, but it is through the foolishness of preaching that God has chosen to confound the wise and save those who would believe. So John shows up preaching. By the time I had arrived in seminary, we were being told that preaching had come to its end. That the best we could hope for was to be good communicators of the Word. There were individuals put before us from the television that you're very familiar with, and so there's no names that need to be spoken. Very conservative men, good men, who had won literally thousands under their ministries. And if you listen to them, their ministry is a ministry of simply teaching. They sit in a chair at a table with the Bible before them. They may have a screen behind them on which they can write. And it is at its very best a lecture, a very good lecture, a God-fearing, biblically based lecture. But it is a far cry from preaching. And so we were told that if John the Baptist came by word of prophecy. John came miraculously. John came in austerity. But the thing I want you to remember the most and never forget is that John came preaching. Lord God, we thank you so much tonight.